They have cast me into the mire, and I am become like dust and ashes. I cry to thee, and thou dost not answer me. Yet I know that thou wilt bring me from death to the meeting place of the globe. 30:19.
The book of Job may be the most disturbing story in the Hebrew Bible. For no apparent reason, Job, a righteous and innocent man, becomes the victim in an unbroken chain of misfortunes, losing his wealth, his power, and his children. Equally astonishing, the cause of Job's terrible suffering is a strange wager made between Satan and God.
The character of God is so mysterious in the book of Job. It's almost as though we're looking at several different gods.
Sometimes I wonder how the book of Job ended up in the Bible. It's a very radical book. It's an attack on the conventional theology.
Who wrote the book of Job? Is Job a fictional character, or did he actually exist? The controversial meaning of the book of Job has been fiercely debated for centuries. Why would a loving God let Satan torment an innocent human being? And is it possible that concealed within this haunting story is an answer to the timeless question, why do innocent and righteous people suffer? These are but a few of the mysteries of the Bible. The book of Job has been called the most baffling book in the Hebrew Bible. Oddly enough, it does not take place in ancient Israel, but in an unknown land called Uz, near the Dead Sea. While no archaeological evidence of Uz exists, scholars believe it to be the home of the Edomites, pagan rivals of the ancient Israelites. It was here, some 2,500 years ago, that a righteous leader named Job was about to become the subject of a terrible wager made between God and Satan. Satan wagers that despite Job's righteousness, he can drive him to such desperation that he will curse God. The result of this chilling contest brings unimaginable suffering upon Job. He loses all that he cherishes in his life. His children, his wife, all his possessions, and finally, even his health. Destitute, afflicted with painful running sores, Job is reduced to huddling in filth. His only home a dung heap in the kingdom where he once reigned as benevolent sovereign.
Let the day perish wherein I was born, and the night in which it was said, a male child is conceived. Let that day be darkness. Job 3:3.
In utter despair, Job is driven to a stunning confrontation with God. Job demands that God explain the reason for his terrible suffering. While the Almighty appears to Job, the meaning of his angry words is cloaked in mystery. And yet, even after this extraordinary communication with the Almighty, Job never learns the cause of his unbearable anguish. The timeless story of Job opens with an impressive description of his immense wealth and power.
Job is pictured by the Bible as a classic Edomite sheikh, a prince of his people, someone who had flocks and camels and maidservants and all of the best things of life. Lavish tents with wonderful rugs and wall hangings, all of the best imports from Mesopotamia and Egypt, because after all, he is the greatest of all the sons of the East.
But despite Job's power and righteousness, almost immediately his story takes a strange turn. The arena moves to the heavenly realms. God is holding court, meeting with his divine council, when he receives a surprising visitor.
Now there came a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. And the Lord said to Satan, "Whence have you come?" Job 1:6.
God's meeting with this shadowy figure is one of the most mysterious events in the Hebrew Bible. It marks the first words spoken between God and Satan. But just who is this strange character known as Satan? Is he the age-old personification of evil whose purpose is the downfall of all humanity? Or is the Satan depicted in the book of Job actually a trusted member of God's inner circle?
I think it's important to keep in mind that this figure in the book of Job, who was referred to as the Satan or the accuser, is not in any sense the figure that later comes to be known as Satan or the devil, the prince of darkness. The Satan figure in the book of Job is really more of an intelligence gatherer. He's the secretive one who reports on the behavior and attitudes of human beings.
Surprisingly, the earliest translations of the book of Job call Satan ha-satan, a Hebrew word which means the adversary or prosecuting attorney.
In the book of Job, Satan is sort of your majesty's loyal opposition. Satan is the one who raises the questions to God that God must grapple with. And in fact, some commentators have taken this as a sort of internal dialogue that God has with God's self. The same way that human beings think, this person loves me, but maybe they only love me for what I give them. God thinks, Job seems to love me, and yet there is a little nagging voice.
It is with impressive cunning that Satan makes his case before God, that Job's faith is only skin deep.
Thou hast rested thy hand of protection upon him. Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. Put forth thy hand now and destroy all that he has, and he will curse thee to thy face. And the Lord said to Satan, Behold, all that he has is in your power. Job 1:9.
And so in a disturbing event unique in the Bible, God makes a wager with Satan.
What God does is to give Satan an extraordinary opportunity, an unusual opportunity, something that, as far as we know from the Bible, Satan never has, and that is the opportunity to cause people physical pain and suffering.
God's decision to let Satan destroy Job's life is as troubling to us today as it was to the people of ancient times. How could the God of Israel, a loving and benevolent presence, make a wager that would bring such terrible suffering to innocent people?
The book of Job is written to test the proposition that good people suffer. And what better way to do that than to take the best person and make him suffer the most, and only then ask why?
With disaster only moments away, the unsuspecting Job is at home, going about his daily task of serving food and drink to his less fortunate neighbors. His own children are savoring a lavish feast at the home of their eldest brother. Moving with frightening haste, Satan, the adversary, sets his destructive plan in motion. All that Job holds dear is about to be annihilated in a series of bizarre calamities. Mysteries of the Bible will be right back. Job, the righteous Edomite ruler, has become an unwitting pawn in a startling wager between God and Satan. He is unaware that his world is teetering dangerously close to the brink. And then, the unthinkable happens.
The fire of God has fallen from heaven and has burned up the sheep and slew the servants with the edge of the sword. Your sons and your daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And behold, there came a great wind from the wilderness and smote the corners of the house, and they are dead. Job 1:16.
In the wake of his tragedy, Job is paralyzed with shock. The Hebrew scriptures tell us that, stricken with grief and confusion, he rips his clothes from his body in an act of mourning. But strangely, in this moment of his greatest anguish, Job does something unexpected. Instead of cursing God for afflicting him with these catastrophes, he falls to his knees and worships God instead.
And he said, "Naked I came out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Job 1:21.
But why would Job, an innocent man who has lost everything that gives meaning to his life, honor God instead of cursing him?
To turn to God and to lay one's heart open before God is wonderful. That's what Job does. So it's not a passivity, but it is also a confidence in God.
In spite of Job's response, Satan is still determined to prove that he can force the righteous Job to curse the Almighty. Satan asks God for another chance, this time to ravage Job's body with a painful disease.
So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord and smote Job with boils from the sole of his foot to the top of his head. Job 2:7.
Even as Job suffers excruciating torment, this remarkable man still refuses to curse God. Scholars have long been intrigued that Job's wife is not nearly so patient. Instead of comforting her suffering husband, she expresses her own unbearable anguish.
Then his wife said to him, "Do you still hold fast your integrity? Curse God and die." Job 2:9.
But why would Job's wife, a woman who loves her husband, speak such seemingly heartless words?
She's suggesting what one scholar has called theological euthanasia. She knows that if you curse God, you immediately get zapped. If you curse God and you immediately get zapped, then you're out of your misery.
And yet, even now, Job refuses to curse the Almighty. Within moments, he receives an unexpected visit from three of his oldest friends, all of them powerful rulers in their own right.
They sit for 7 days and 7 nights with Job, and they don't say a word, they just cry. And I think this is intended to teach us that your first reaction to someone else's tragedy, if you really care, is not to go explain to them why the tragedy isn't so bad and how they'll get over it. The first responsibility of someone who cares is to weep with them.
With his friends as compassionate listeners, Job, who has lost all he holds dear, at last voices his pain.
Why did I not die from the womb? Why did I come forth at birth? Why was I reared at my mother's knee? Why did I suck the breasts? For now I should have been laid in the grave and been quiet. Job 3:11.
To be honest with you, I'm not sure if it's the physical suffering of Job that pained him the most. I have a sense that it was the doubt. It was the wrestling in his mind and in his heart with the doubts that he faced about whether the universe really makes the kind of sense he thought it made.
At last, the silent friends feel compelled to speak. Their secret feelings about Job's suffering are suddenly exposed.
If you were innocent and upright, surely then he would be attentive to you and would make the habitation of your righteousness prosperous. Job 8:6.
Job's friends express a view common in ancient times, that Job's suffering proves that he must be a sinner who deserves punishment. But Job's response to them is startling, perhaps even blasphemous. He insists that God has somehow made a mistake, that he, Job, has never sinned.
My face is troubled with weeping, and on my eyelids is the shadow of death. But not for any iniquity in my hands. My prayer also is pure. Job 16:16.
The wisdom literature of the Bible, which we see especially in the book of Proverbs, tells us again and again how whatever you do, you get rewarded or punished in equal measure. If you try to cheat someone else, you will be cheated. If you're good to someone else, goodness will come back to you. And the book of Job comes along to say, no, it is not so simple.
The suffering of Job poses a profound question. Should human beings behave ethically to receive earthly rewards from God? Or is to live ethically its own reward?
I think that many of the major faith traditions, certainly Christianity and Judaism, and certainly also Islam, encourages us to move to a point where we act out of devotion rather than self-interest. And I think that the book of Job asks that question very deeply. Can we get to a point where our faith is based on an act of devotion to our God and not an act of self-interest?
Mysteries of the Bible will return in a moment. We now return to Mysteries of the Bible.
Under the crushing weight of his suffering, Job huddles despondently on a dung heap, a man whose world lies in ruins around him. Now, when others might simply yield to despair, he decides on a bold course of action. Job dares to confront God himself. Fearlessly, Job swears an ancient Hebrew oath and demands that God appear before him.
Job challenges God, saying, "You are holding me accountable as a bad person, as a sinner. Bring your proof. I swear that I am innocent. Bring proof to show me that I'm wrong, and if you can't bring proof, I demand that you apologize."
Let me be weighed in a just balance, that God may know my integrity. If I have trampled upon the rights of others, let the provocations of God lay me low. Job 31:6.
In biblical times, to make such a demand of the Almighty is an unthinkable act of defiance. Has Job's utter despair pushed him to risk the wrath of God? In a spellbinding moment, Job will experience what few other mortals have: direct communication with the Almighty. The Bible tells us that God's voice thunders forth from a whirlwind.
Who is this who gives counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins now like a valiant man, for I will question you, and you will answer me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Declare it if you have understanding. Job 38:2.
Job is awestruck in the presence of God. Even though the Almighty does not offer him the explanation he so urgently demands, instead, God cloaks his response in some of the most poetic, most enigmatic language ever to appear in a religious text.
Where is the dwelling place of light, and where is the place of darkness? Do you know its borders and the path to its house? Do you remember when you were born? And do you know if you will live many days? Job 38:19.
Here's where it gets interesting. Because the answer is not clear, it's either so profound that we can't figure it out, or so radical that somewhere along the line, copyists and sages and editors changed it because they didn't want us to hear what the author had to say.
Out of whose womb did the dew and ice come forth? And who begot the hoary frost of heaven? The waters are hardened like stone, and the face of the deep is frozen. Job 38:29.
The meaning of God's words may always remain a mystery. Scholars believe this part of the story was crafted by an unknown author in about 400 before the Common Era, a person many experts call the Shakespeare of the Bible. Inexplicably, this writer's work is found nowhere else in the scriptures.
This is one of the greatest writers of civilization, yet we don't know his name, we don't know where he lived, we can't even tell you for certain what century he lived in. We can say some things. He was brilliant. He knew about the souls and the hearts and the questions of the Israelites. Who is this man? Did he suffer as Job suffered, and is that why he can write this story? That's a mystery we'll never be able to solve.
Even though God answers none of Job's burning questions, Job experiences a profound spiritual transformation.
Who am I to think that I can give counsel without knowledge? I will keep silent and repent in dust and ashes. Job 42:3.
A humble Job accepts his destiny. Surprisingly, God offers to punish Job's three friends for blaming Job for his own misfortune. In an act of compassion tempered by his own suffering, Job chooses to forgive them instead.
Now, politically, this is delicious. I mean, how often do you get double-crossed in life and get the chance to hesitate and then forgive your friends who were wrong?
In spite of Job's pain, he has never cursed God. Satan has lost his wager. And God gives Job even greater wealth and power than he had before his ordeal began. The Hebrew Bible tells us that Job lives for another 140 years.
So Job died, being old and contented and full of days. Job 42:16.
This sudden, happy ending has puzzled scholars for centuries. How can a story that probes the very essence of human suffering conclude with such a simplistic ending?
I think that was a Hollywood ending tacked on by somebody much later. In this case, the real ending is when Job and God make contact. My guess is that two things happened to the book of Job as we know it. Now, one, that the poet himself, who wrote it, had to change it. And two, that years later, maybe centuries later, it was further changed to mollify the people who were scandalized by the book of Job.
Another facet of the story still baffles historians. Why, after playing such a destructive role in Job's life, does Satan disappear so abruptly from the story?
I think it's extremely significant that Satan does not reappear at the end of the book of Job. Satan has nothing left. He's played his trump card and has lost.
centuries, archaeologists have traveled the Holy Land, obsessed with the search for clues, seeking to authenticate the ancient stories of the Bible. And yet to this day, there is no hard evidence to prove that the Job of the Bible ever lived. Where did Job's story, with its universal questions about human suffering, originate? Did an unknown author report events in the life of a wealthy, righteous sufferer who really did exist? Or was Job a fictional character created as part of an ancient folktale to teach the value of patience?
There's no inscription that says Job lived here. But there are all kinds of details in the book of Job that actually point to the fact that he's historical. These include the fact that his wealth is measured in cattle and slaves. That's a style of the book of Genesis and of that time. There's the way that Job offers his own sacrifices, which is characteristic of the period prior to the time the Israelites are in the Promised Land.
You're dealing with an archetype, a man who's so impossibly good that he can't be based on a real figure. But that's not the point. Even if the person described in the book of Job never really existed, there are no shortage of Jobs.
Scholars may never solve the riddle of Job's existence, but many believe that the origins of his story may be found in a far more distant past than ever imagined. Buried in the shifting sands of the Iraqi desert, at the site of the once mighty Sumerian civilization, and left to time, are a set of clay tablets. They are discovered in the mid-20th century. Archaeologists believe these tablets to be crafted at least 3,500 years ago, 1,000 years before the Book of Job was written. Etched on these crumbling shards are markings that offer a startling revelation. A Sumerian folktale that appears to be the first written description of human suffering. Was this story the inspiration for the Book of Job? The despair expressed by its ancient Sumerian author is strikingly similar to Job's lament in the Hebrew Bible.
Evil fate holds me in its hand, carries off my breath of life. Malignant sickness bathes my body. Ancient Sumerian poem.
Like Job, this ill-fated Sumerian is pious, wealthy, and the head of a large family. Overwhelmed with illness and financial disaster, he pleads with the gods to intercede on his behalf. And like Job, this victim is also restored to his former wealth.
He turned the man's suffering into joy, set by him the kindly genii as a watch and guardian, gave him angels with gracious mien. Ancient Sumerian poem.
The Sumerians were not the only ancient people seeking to probe the meaning of human suffering. Other civilizations at the time of the Hebrews were also haunted by the same questions.
There's a book in Babylonian called Ludlul Baal Namiki. That just means, let me praise the God of wisdom. And in that book, there's a little bit of material that's like the book of Job. That's a kind of a discourse on misery and suffering and so on. But sometimes people have said it's the, quote, Babylonian Job, because it's the closest thing in Babylonian to what we have in the book of Job.
Throughout the world, every major religion wrestles with the problem of why innocent people suffer. The Hindus believe all humans suffer, innocents and sinners alike. They say that suffering is always an illusion, almost comparable to a desert mirage. To them, the invisible world of spirit is the only true reality. Buddha taught a similar philosophy that suffering is caused by clinging to material objects, possessions, other people, events. Suffering and sorrow can be relieved by learning to give up this attachment, by living fully in each moment as it arises. In the Islamic religion, suffering is seen as a test by God to reveal worthiness. Anyone can be tested, even an innocent and righteous man like Job. Mysteries of the Bible will be right back.
Mysteries of the Bible continues.
In the 2,500 years since the Book of Job was written, countless sufferers have found a special kinship with the man who dared to lash out at God. Perhaps the need to solve the mystery of human suffering is more urgent in our own times than ever before. The mid-19th century was America's darkest hour as the nation threatened to tear itself apart in civil war. The divided land looked to one man, Abraham Lincoln, for its salvation. No one felt the anguish of the nation more acutely than the president himself. Not surprisingly, Lincoln found a kindred spirit in the suffering Job. In fact, one of the president's housekeepers would later tell reporters that her employer read and reread the Book of Job, finding solace in the words. Like Job, Lincoln also grappled with his own personal torment. His favorite son, Willie, died tragically of an illness at the age of 11. And his wife, Mary Todd, fought a losing battle with mental illness. Through it all, like Job, Abraham Lincoln continued to demand to know why.
I've always felt that Abraham Lincoln was our most Jobin president. And I don't use Jobin to mean patient. I mean Jobin to mean questioning and challenging.
Despite the terrible ordeal of the Civil War, perhaps nowhere was the agony of Job more profoundly expressed in modern times than in the Holocaust, in which millions of innocents were murdered by the Nazis on a scale that escapes all reason. The tragic irony of this dark time is that the Jewish people, whose holy book probes the question of undeserved suffering, became the modern embodiment of Job's anguish. The question which haunts each survivor is the question which haunted Job himself. How can a loving God have allowed this horror to take place?
In the Book of Job, Job turns to God and says, you know, I wish I could bring you into court, but I know that that's not something I could ever do. Thousands of years later, in Auschwitz, in one of the death camps during the Second World War, there was a group of inmates, of Jewish inmates of that camp, who before their death convened a Beit Din, a Jewish court of law, and they put God on trial, and they found God guilty.
Ours is the century of the Holocaust. Ours is the century of Cambodia and Bosnia and Rwanda and all sorts of terrible crimes. If you're an alert, caring, compassionate person, you must confront the question, why do these things keep on happening? Why don't people learn from history? Why can't we put an end to the suffering?
Why are innocent people forced to suffer? Perhaps this remains the most profound mystery in the Bible, the ultimate test of all religious faith. Is this the reason why so many question God's existence? Or does the mystery of human suffering only draw us more deeply into the life of the Spirit? A perplexing question which may haunt humankind to the end of time.
We may never have a definitive answer to the question of why there is so much evil in God's world. But I do remember a story about a man who looked up at God once and he said, God, you know, there's so much pain and suffering in your world. Why don't you send help? And God said, I did send help. I sent you.
Is the Biography Channel.
You want to be yourself, but you're not allowed to be yourself.
This is the Biography Channel.
I was just beside myself with anger and disappointment.
This is the Biography Channel.
I'm the only actress he knows you have to pay to keep your clothes on.
Reality meets personality only on the Biography Channel.
Biography Channel. What a concept!